Spoiler! According to standard cosmological theories on the shape of the universe, it has no center, that's all. Now, you can decide to simply skip this video, or keep listening to what we have to say. I'll give you 3 seconds, leave it up to you. 3, 2, 1. Are you still here? Well, I guess it's time to explain it a bit better. For a center point to exist, that point would have to somehow be special with respect to the universe as a whole. In addition, to define a center of the universe, one should try to define it. It could be defined as a center of rotation, or is it a center of mass, or maybe something similar to the center of mass, an object where the amount of electric charge is on average the same in all directions surrounding it, a center of charge. It could be the center of a curvature, or a center of expansion. Finally, the center of the universe could be some object or feature that exists only at one spot, such as a supermassive black hole or a superlarge nebula. But observations indicate that all types of objects are randomly peppered throughout the universe, and the physics itself indicates that there is no center of rotation, no center of mass, no center of charge, and no center of expansion or curvature. But the real interesting thing here is that once it was believed that we were the center of everything, it could be worth it to retrace somehow the historical and cultural steps that brought us to this point, in order to try to understand why there's no center of the universe. Let's dive in. In the 4th century BCE Greece, philosophers developed the geocentric model based on astronomical observations. This model proposed that the center of the universe lies at the center of a spherical, stationary Earth around which the Sun, Moon, planets, and stars all rotate. The most highly developed geocentric model was that of Ptolemy of Alexandria, 2nd century CE. Ptolemy studied the Greek knowledge of the universe and believed that the Earth was in the center of it, with many spheres around it. It is called the geocentric theory because geo means earth in Greek. Ptolemy saw the universe with a naked eye as a bunch of spheres circling the earth, which was in the center, of course. Because Ptolemy could only see the universe in that way, he thought that the moon, Mercury, Venus, and the sun all revolved around the earth. Ptolemy was not certain with his theory of the universe, so he incorporated Hipparchus's notion of epicycles, put forth a few centuries earlier to work out his calculations. Epicycles were small invisible circular orbits that were said to be on planets while moving. With this and Ptolemy's tables, astronomers were said to prove Ptolemy's theory right, and for many years people believed Ptolemy's theory. The geocentric model had seemingly logical evidence. First of all, if the Earth were moving, then wouldn't we feel it, or feel a strong wind in the direction of movement? Also, if the Earth really moved around the Sun, then wouldn't we see the stars move? This last phenomenon, called parallax, is a real thing, but is much too small to be seen without a telescope due to the extreme distance to stars. At this point, the Earth was thought to be at the center of the universe, and the Earth was the center of the universe. This theory was largely accepted until the 16th century when a smart guy named Nicolaus Copernicus developed the so-called heliocentric model. Before him, there were actually a bunch of people that had the same idea in their mind. But the Christian Church's doctrine was pretty much solidified at that time, and it had been heavily influenced by Greek and Roman philosophers, and so by the geocentric model. The geocentric model puts humans in a special place at the center of everything, and that's why this way of thinking was largely diffused. It is a human nature to want to feel special. Therefore, your religion offers as one of its fundamental beliefs that you are not only a special person, created personally by your divine being, but you live in a special place at the center of everything. Copernicus never liked the Earth-based view of the universe, yet he did not publicly announce his views until he was older. In fact, anyone who opposed church doctrine has been branded a heretic, and that would destroy your reputation, put you in prison, sentence you to death, or even all of the above. Copernicus did not invent the idea of a heliocentric, sun-centered system. In fact, the notion that the Earth revolves around the Sun had been proposed as early as the 3rd century BCE by Aristarchus of Samos, but had received no support from most other ancient astronomers. Copernicus was the first modern person to advance this model. It was able to easily explain things that the geocentric system had a hard time doing, most notably the seemingly retrograde motion of the planets. The planets usually follow an eastward direction in the sky, but sometimes they mysteriously flip and travel westward. The geocentric model attempted to solve this by adding extra orbits upon orbits that the planets would follow. However, the heliocentric model explains this with the Earth simply reversing the direction of movement relative to the planet being observed. Copernicus's publication on the revolution of the celestial spheres was not published well until after he died, in order for him to avoid being persecuted by the church. What followed is often called the Copernican Revolution, but is actually not much of a revolution at all. The book was published in Latin, so the general public was not able to read it. Academics could, but very few learned people were willing to face the church and risk death. It wasn't even until 73 years later after it was published, 1616, that the church considered it important enough to place on its index of prohibited books. Time shift from the Ptolemaic model to the heliocentric model was called the Copernican Revolution. Some personalities distinguished themselves among others, contributing to boosting the Copernican Revolution. They were Tycho Brahe and Johannes Kepler. Tycho's principal merit was to make great strides in the area of observations. Further advancement in the understanding of the cosmos would require new, more accurate observations than those that Copernicus relied on. In 1572, Tycho Brahe observed a new star in the constellation Cassiopeia. For 18 months, it shone brightly in the sky with no visible parallax, indicating that it was part of the heavenly region of the stars, according to Greeks and the Church's model. However, according to that model, no changes could take place in the heavens, so Tycho's observation was a major discredit to those theories. In 1577, Tycho observed a great comet in the sky. Based on his parallax observations, the comet passed through the region of the planets. According to the old theory, only uniform circular motion on solid spheres existed in this region, making it impossible for a comet to enter it. Tycho included that there was no such spheres, raising the question of what kept a planet in orbit. Kepler found employment as an assistant to Tycho Brahe. He was then able to use Brahe's extensive observation to make remarkable breakthroughs in astronomy, such as the three laws of planetary motion. Kepler's three laws of planetary motion can be described as follows. 1. The path of the planets about the sun is elliptical in shape, with the center of the sun being located at one focus, the law of the ellipse. 2. An imaginary line drawn from the center of the sun to the center of a planet will sweep out equal areas in equal intervals of time, the law of equal areas. And 3. The ratio of the squares of the periods of any two planets is equal to the ratio of the cubes of their average distance from the sun, the law of harmonies. These were such a great contribution to a new vision of our world as part of the universe. After Kepler, Galileo Galilei came. He developed his telescope with enough magnification to allow him to study Venus and to discover that it has phases just like a moon. He also noticed that some objects were orbiting Jupiter, and this is how he discovered Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto, the planet's four major satellites. It was January 7th, 1610. The discovery was a strong argument in favor of the heliocentric theory of Copernicus, because it showed that not all objects in the solar system orbited the planet Earth. At this point, the geocentric theory was very hard to defend, but the decisive blow to the old model arrived on 5th of July, 1687, when the Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy was published. The author was Sir Isaac Newton. It states Newton's laws of motion forming the foundation of classical mechanics. Newton's law of universal gravitation and the consequent derivation of Kepler's laws of planetary motion. Kepler obtained his laws empirically. Newton's great merit was to give them an analytic foundation, a description, and a physical motivation. In formulating his physical theories, Newton developed and used mathematical methods which included the field of calculus. He is the king of calculus. At this point, the sun was at the center of the universe. What happened next? In the early 20th century, the discovery of other galaxies and the development of the Big Bang theory led to the development of cosmological models of a homogeneous isotropic universe, which lacks a central point and is expanding at all its points. Before the 1920s, it was generally believed that there were no galaxies other than our own, see, for example, the Great Debate. Thus, to astronomers of previous centuries, there was no distinction between a hypothetical center of the galaxy and a hypothetical center of the universe. The first one who correctly speculated that the Milky Way might be a body of a huge number of stars held together by gravitational forces rotating about a galactic center was Thomas Wright in 1750. In a treatise in 1755, Immanuel Kant elaborated on Wright's idea about the structure of the Milky Way. In 1785, William Herschel proposed such a model based on observations and measurements, leading to the scientific acceptance of galactocentrism, a form of heliocentrism with the Sun at the center of the Milky Way. At this point, the Sun was no longer the center of the universe, but it was the center of the Milky Way, and it was the only galaxy. But then, the shocking discoveries of Nova within what was then called the Andromeda Nebula suggested that maybe the Milky Way wasn't the only galaxy in the universe, because those Nova were drastically fainter than Novas in the Milky Way, and it was estimated that Andromeda was 500,000 light-years away. Such a faraway object could not be part of our galaxy. Anyway, this was still a matter of debate, until Edwin Hubble settled the debate about whether other galaxies existed in 1925, when he identified extragalactic Cepheid variable stars for the first time on astronomical photos of M31. Hubble also demonstrated that the redshift of other galaxies is proportional to their distance from the Earth. The redshift observations of Hubble, in which galaxies appear to be moving away from us at a rate proportional to their distance from us, are now understood to be a result of the metric expansion of space. This is the increase of the distance between two distant parts of the universe, with time as an eccentric expansion whereby the scale of space itself changes. All of this led to the so-called cosmological principle, which states that the universe is homogeneous. The same observational evidence is available to observers in a different location in the universe, and is isotropic. The same observational evidence is available by looking in any direction in the universe. And ladies and gentlemen, a homogeneous isotropic universe does not have a center. Be sure to comment down below and let us know what you think.